Yes, I started out life as a scientist and then became a copywriter, so a bit like Don Draper. I spent 15 years pitching my ideas, and I can make the analogy, it's like standing up naked in front of someone when you have to, in a way, bare your soul with your ideas. You created these ideas, and there you are presenting them, waiting for someone to reject you. So it's quite a confronting thing. The last 12 years, though, what I've been doing is actually helping marketers evaluate other people's pitches. And so what I want to do today is take you through some of the lessons that I've learned, but more specifically, probably the great pitch guy of advertising is Don Draper. Now, who's familiar with Mad Men? Okay, Don Draper is actually an amalgam of some of the great advertising creatives, especially through the 50s, 60s, and 70s. So what you've got here is the pinnacle of what it takes to pitch a creative idea. So there's a lot to be learned there. But I've got another question for you. Hands up who regularly pitches on a daily or weekly basis. Okay, everyone with your hands down are actually deluding yourself. Because as human beings, we pitch in every aspect of our lives. We don't think of it as pitching, but when you go home and you want to go to a certain restaurant or you want to have holidays in a certain place, you're actually pitching your ideas to the people around you. And so what I'm going to talk about today won't just help you necessarily in your business life, but it can also help you in your personal life, in your friendships, because it can make you more effective at actually putting your ideas forward to other people. So to start that, let's actually take a lesson from Mr. Don Draper from Mad Men.
This is Joe Harriman and Lynn Taylor. No Eastmans today, unfortunately. They're all back in the lab.
It's a wonderful facility, but they don't take vacations.
What do they show? Slides of them working?
So have you figured out a way to work the wheel into it?
We know it's hard because wheels aren't really seen as exciting technology, even though they are the original.
Well, technology is a glittering lure, but there's the rare occasion when the public can be engaged on a level beyond flash if they have a sentimental bond with the product. My first job, I was in-house at a fur company with this old pro copywriter, Greek, named Teddy. And Teddy told me the most important idea in advertising is new. Creates an itch. You simply put your product in there as a kind of calamine lotion. But he also talked about a deeper bond with the product. Nostalgia. It's delicate, but potent. Sweetheart.
Teddy told me that in Greek, nostalgia literally means the pain from an old wound. It's a twinge in your heart, far more powerful than memory alone. This device isn't a spaceship. It's a time machine. Goes backwards, forwards. It takes us to a place where we ache to go again. It's not called the wheel. It's called the carousel. Lets us travel the way a child travels. Around and around, and back home again. To a place where we know we are loved.
Good luck at your next meeting.
That's a powerful pitch. And I'd like to not be the next agency that was being presented to after that. Because that was the final episode of Series 1, and I think what we saw there was the real power of Don Draper as a character to be able to really tap in and have empathy. It's quite an emotional presentation, and that's really where the power is. But what else can we learn about it, or learn from this? The first is this concept of new. New is such a powerful thing, and if we're talking about innovation, then naturally we're going to be coming up with new concepts. New is something that actually draws people to you, draws you to your ideas, because people are attracted to new. New ideas, new technology, the iPad, the iPhone, and then they're followed up by the Galaxy S, but it's the new. It's when you're at that leading edge of change that you draw people to you. And he talks about it being like a niche that requires your product as calamine lotion. But what he forgets is that there's another double-edged sword, another edge to new, which is fear, because people fear change. So we have this conundrum, this tension that happens, because we love the new, but we fear change. And that's such a powerful area when you're pitching an idea. The danger is, if you're pitching something that's not new and doesn't create that fear, you're going to get people going, oh yeah, that's a good idea, but they won't do anything about it. It's only when you get that element of fear that you get the adrenaline rush where people start wanting to do something. So that's why it's an area when you're pitching your ideas, you want to get that balance right. You want to lure people in with the new, but also be aware that if it's truly an innovative idea, then they're going to resist change. The other thing about Don Draper's pitch is that he's aware of the fact that he's actually pitching intangibles. I mean, the tangible thing is the product sitting on the table. You know, there was slide projectors for many years, and here he is presenting the wheel. You know, the best idea Kodak could come up with is calling it the wheel. But he realized he wasn't selling a slide projector. What was he selling?
Memories.
Dreams, desire, passion. He was selling emotions to people. Because in sitting there, I mean, I love that line where he says, we're going to call it the carousel, because just like the way a child plays, around and back home again. I mean, he's selling the intangible. And that's the other thing that you have to realize, is that we live in this world that demands facts and figures. But you know what, as human beings, we don't naturally default to facts and figures. Our first point of reaction is emotion. How many people here have felt a decision before they've actually made it? Because that's what we are, as human beings. But how many people here have been told that we should make fact-based decisions? It's a great conundrum. Another great conundrum about being a human being is that we've got these two brains. We've got our reptilian brain that keeps us alive and keeps us safe. And then we've got this higher cortex that allows us to sort through facts and figures and analyze and rationalize. But you know what? When you're pitching, what you're pitching to and what you should be pitching to is that reptilian midbrain. That part where people feel rather than rationalize. Because it's a much more powerful place to get a decision is when someone feels that decision. And one of the ways to do that, and this is a classic technique, is problem solution. When you come up with a solution, the very next step you should do is create the problem. If you come up with a solution to solve a problem, even easier. But it doesn't have to work that way. I mean, many great innovations have come from someone having a flash of brilliance and can't actually define the problem. But that's okay. You just recreate, backstep from the solution to get the problem. And the more complex the problem, the more powerful the solution will be. And the more specific the problem, then the more specific your solution will be. There's a great opportunity here in that by defining the problem well, you can make your solution look like the only solution. And that's such a powerful thing to do, because if you're competitively pitching against other people, it means that you can make your solution look more right than theirs just by defining the problem a certain way. And the more powerful or complex the problem, then obviously the more powerful that solution will be. Another technique is to take the audience on a journey. And that's one of the reasons for doing this, is that we spend so much time coming up with our idea, but then when we're presenting it to someone, we forget that they haven't been living with this idea as long as we have. You know, we've had hours, days, weeks, or months to probe it, turn it, interrogate it, twist it, torture it, and know it inside and out. But then you're standing there presenting it to someone, and you wonder why they're not getting it. It's the first time they've heard it. And what their brain's actually thinking is, what's in it for me, and will this cause me a problem? So a really good technique is to take people on the inventor's journey. Now, anyone here studied storytelling or archetypes, things like that, yeah? So the inventor's journey is very much like the hero's journey. This is like the archetypal story about trial and tribulation, obstacle and victory. But in telling that story, what you do is you actually demonstrate that you've considered all of the things that the person may be thinking that you haven't considered. By taking them on the journey, you're taking them on a personal journey of creation. And it's such a powerful technique. Now, I've been in situations where, in actual fact, the idea came in a moment like that, but what I had to do was then recreate the journey so that I could take people with me. But that's okay, because it's a story. We saw Don Draper take the Kodak guys on a journey of his family. He also took them on another journey, which was the story about, what do you call him, Teddy, the Greek copywriter. I'm sure today you'd have to call him Theo, but in the 1960s, Teddy, the old Greek copywriter, also took Don Draper on that journey of learning about copywriting and advertising. So stories are an incredibly powerful way of taking people through on that journey. The other thing you need to do, especially when we operate in this intangible area, is make it real for people. You know, you guys are working in financial services, and a lot of the products and services that you work with are largely intangible. It's not like you actually make a physical product. Out at Ford, when they design a car, they make a prototype, they make a model that people can touch, feel, smell, look at, hold. So what you need to do when you're working in the intangible is find ways of making people feel and the product as if it's real. Now notice all of the things that I referred to are actually sensory. Is that creaky board? It's sensory. Touch, feel, smell, taste, hold. Because what we don't want people to do is go into the rational. We want them to feel the product. We want it to be real for them. So you've got to think of ways of doing that. How can you do that? You can do it through using analogy. You can create. In advertising, they use storyboards. They use scripts. We do theme reels. It's whatever it takes to make an idea appear before people and appear to be real. Because people believe what they see, they believe what they hear when they're in that emotional space. The underlying thing is use emotions. Don't be afraid to use emotions. In fact, if you allow your audience to go into the rational and the analytical, you're often lost. Because what we want someone to do is actually make a commitment. And the most powerful commitment they'll make is an emotional commitment. If we get into a rational discussion about whether your idea is strong enough, there's going to be different points of view, and suddenly people will be producing facts and figures. What we want is the pitch is about getting someone to make an emotional commitment and then to support that with facts and figures. Now, I'll give you a prime example. BMW is a German-engineered vehicle, but how do they sell it? They call it the ultimate driving machine. The way they position the product is about the experience of driving. If you look at the advertising that they use, it's all about the emotion of driving, the performance, the power, the feeling of the person behind that car, behind the wheel of that car. But then what they do is they immediately support that emotional decision with a whole lot of facts and figures. You look at the brochure, you look at the website, there's all these things about how the engine's manufactured and how the suspension system works, because they know that people buy their car for an emotional reason, but then they need to justify it rationally. No one I know that drives a BMW will say, I bought it to feel really good when I drive it. But everyone will tell you how it's been, you know, engineered, how it performs, how the braking system works, how it's safer, it's more fuel, it's got better fuel economy. They'll give you chapter and verse. But that's because the pitch worked emotionally, and then the facts work to support their emotions. And it's the same in business, it's the same in every aspect of life. We as human beings make emotional decisions. And on Wednesday in Sydney, when we were talking about this afterwards, someone came up to me and said, but we're surrounded by people that are all fact-based. And I go, they say they're fact-based because what they're trying to do is justify every decision they make based on facts. But all of the studies show human beings make decisions based on their emotions. Facts are there to support the decision that they've already made emotionally. When you talk to the angel investors in Silicon Valley, they say the business case is one thing, but what they really choose is the caliber of the person. Because no one really knows which startup's going to work or not. But they know that if they back the person that gives them the confidence that they can deliver, they're more likely to get a winner than not. This leads directly from the idea of being emotional, and that's to be a poet, be an artist. Be someone who uses words and uses emotions. You use metaphors, you use stories, you use analogies. I mean, the Don Draper presentation that we saw there, how much of that was just sheer poetry? The idea of going around and around in circles until you return home to a place where you know you're loved. I mean, if that's not poetry, what is? When he talks about the definition of nostalgia, the definition of nostalgia is a hurt, an unhealed pain. Now, such powerful language, and you shouldn't be afraid to use that in business. You know, one of the things that should come across when you're pitching is your commitment and belief and your emotional belief in this, in what you're pitching. Because if you believe it, then the people you're presenting to are more likely to believe you. The hardest thing in the world for me as a creative person was pitching work that I didn't believe in. But there's a saying in advertising that once you master sincerity, anything's possible. This is also a very common advertising saying. It says, sell the sizzle, not the sausage. What that means is that there's three levels of things that you can talk about a product or service. The first one is the features. What are the features of this? The next is the benefits, but then there's rational benefits and there's emotional benefits. And when I was starting out as a copywriter, one of the guys that took me, my Teddy, I guess, took me under his wing and he said, it doesn't matter what you look at, what product will always have features, rational benefits and emotional benefits. And I said, you know, it can't be every product. He said, a leather armchair. It's pretty prosaic, isn't it? A leather armchair. It's a leather armchair. That's the feature. Leather and an armchair. What are the rational benefits? It's hard wearing, it's color fast, and it's made of premium leather. But what are the emotional benefits? I said, and he said, at the end of the day, when you're exhausted and you lower your backside into that chair, it'll just envelop you and make you feel like royalty. And I thought, there is someone that knows how to turn something as plain and dull as a leather armchair into a real emotional benefit. Now, that's about right. This is about attention. And I said before, getting that adrenaline and that desire in the right balance will get you someone's attention for about 20 minutes. I've been speaking for 22 minutes, so I can almost guarantee that every single person in this room has wandered off in their thoughts at least once in the last 20 minutes. And the fact that I've said that has now brought your attention back to what I'm saying. And it's true, if you take more than 20 minutes to pitch something, if you haven't got that person on your side and emotionally committed in 20 minutes, then you walk straight out the door. Because if you can't get someone on side in that time, you've lost their attention. There are techniques like I just did to pull them back in, but we've built this world where we have to have 1 hour meetings. So a 1 hour meeting is 10 to 15 meetings of people chatting about what they did yesterday or on the weekend or what they're going to do, which is the let's bond, and then about 20 productive minutes, and then another 20 or 30 minutes where I don't know what we're doing, because no one in that room is actually paying attention. Now, companies like Google and Nike and Apple have 30-minute meetings. They actually have 25-minute meetings, because they know that no one's going to pay attention for more than 20. So how long should you pitch for? How long should you pitch for? No more than 20 minutes. And if you haven't got someone in the first 3 minutes, and this is Jerry, everyone know Jerry Seinfeld, the comedian? Jerry Seinfeld says it doesn't matter how famous he is, if he doesn't get a laugh every 3 minutes, he's lost the audience. If you can't get the people in 3 minutes, you're going to be struggling to keep their attention all the way through. So your pitch can't be more than 20 minutes, and if you can keep it to 3 minutes, even better. Who's heard of the elevator pitch? Yeah, it's really was popular in the 80s. You know, you've got to have your elevator pitch. You've got to get the elevator pitch right, okay. So what the elevator pitch, the concept was, you should, if you've got a good idea, you should be able to pitch it to someone in the time it took to travel between floors in an elevator. I don't know, with high-speed elevators, that's probably, what, 20 seconds? But in my building, where our office is, it's probably about 2.5 hours, if you're lucky. So there's a formula, and I'm going to give you the formula for the elevator pitch. I'll take this down. This is the formula for the perfect elevator pitch. For, insert target customer here, who are dissatisfied with insert current offering in the market. My idea slash product, insert your new idea or product, provides, insert key problem solution. So my idea and product have, insert these key benefits. So it's the who, what is the problem, how you're going to fix it, with your idea, because here are the benefits. So it's a who, what, where, when, how type structure. And I'll give you an example of how that works. So I tried to pull one that's financial services. For investors wanting a 10% cash yield or better, who are dissatisfied with risky investments such as equities, my airport deal is a project with low risk and lots of protection that provides a current cash flow, and unlike most development projects, you can cash out whenever you like. Now, it's got all of the essential ingredients for the elevator pitch, because it tells people who, what, where, when, how, why. The trouble is, it's just not that compelling. It's actually a checklist, and what it lacks is emotion. It's almost like the elevator pitch is the thing that you do when you can't pitch. If you're giving an elevator pitch, you've actually missed the opportunity of truly engaging your audience and the person you're trying to influence with a real pitch. And that's important. There's times when you have to walk away from a pitch if you don't get to pitch it right, because otherwise you're just wasting your time. And I'm not talking about just generating ideas. I'm talking about when you want to get true buy-in from someone else. So that's not just pitching to your boss to get funding or getting approval. This is when you want to collaborate with someone else. You can use these techniques to get someone else to buy into the project with you. As I said before, you can use this at any time in your life to get people to emotionally buy in to what it is that your idea is. And the last thing is, no matter what, you have to practice, practice, practice. And I'm not talking Seve Ballesteros, golfer who said, the more I practice, the luckier I get. I'm not talking about practicing your pitch over and over again. I'm talking about practicing pitching. I'm talking about looking for opportunities every day to pitch something to people you know. Because the more you do practice pitching, the better you'll get at it. In fact, you'll get to the point that people don't even realise you're pitching to them. Suddenly your friends and family and colleagues will be saying yes to you all the time because you've engaged them emotionally, and then they'll be sitting there going, how come I'm doing all this work for him or her? You know, because you do, you become much more effective at actually getting people to buy into the things that you want to do. So what I'd say to you is go home tonight and look for opportunities this weekend to actually pitch your ideas to people. You know, if you're pitching a holiday, a family holiday, or a holiday with your partner, you're not going to go, I think we should go to Europe because there's really cheap deals. Yeah, okay, well, but it's cieaper to go to Launceston. You talk about romance or excitement or adventure. This is about learning to stop relying on facts and figures and start working on how to engage people emotionally. So let's sum up. If you want to pitch like Don Draper, there's some things you have to remember. I'm referring to my list, so I don't miss any. First of all, create a problem and then set your idea up as a solution. And as I said, the more specific you make the problem to your solution, the better. Take people on a journey. Take them along with you. Give them time to really get to appreciate what you've created here. Not too much time, you've only got 20 minutes. We're not talking war and peace, but just take them with your thinking so that they can see where you, how you got there. And make it real for people. Look for the opportunities of finding ways of bringing it to life. Whether it's a slideshow or photos, or showing them examples of what other people have done. Don't be afraid of emotions. No matter how rational we think the world is, how rational our organisations are that we work in, how analytical everyone is, the thing is that rationality and analysis are always used to support emotional decisions. But no one makes a rational decision an emotional decision after doing the analysis and rationale. So use the power of the emotion. Be a poet, use analogies, use metaphors, tell stories, engage people emotionally. Don't bore them to death with facts and figures. In fact, there's a saying that as soon as someone starts referring to your Excel spreadsheet, you haven't got a chance in hell of getting that approved. Focus on the emotional benefit and not the rational features or the rational benefits. Again, emotion, emotion, and keep it tight. If you can do it in 3 minutes, pitch in 3 minutes, but don't take longer than 20 minutes. And I'm not talking about, when I talk about 20 minutes, that's the 20 minutes to get the emotional commitment from whoever you're pitching to. Once they're emotionally connected, you can then spend 2 or 3 days giving them the facts and figures to help them support it. But you'll have their attention for no more than 20 minutes. Use an elevator pitch just to help you sort your thinking out, but never give an elevator pitch, because it'll never engage people on that emotional level. And finally, practice, practice, practice. As I said, start practicing today, because there's no point starting to practice 2 hours before your next pitch. Thanks very much. Thank you.